Hello everyone, my name is Eric Poznanski and I'm going to present our work on handwriting word recognition using convolutional neural network. This is joint work with Lear Wolf. So, given an image of a word, we wish to provide the image text. If the word is handwritten, we call it handwriting word recognition. If the word is part of a scene, like an image from Google Street View, we call it scene text recognition. Now, obviously, we're not the first to use deep learning for text recognition. In fact, if you take a look at benchmarks of handwriting recognition and syntax recognition, one can see that the state of the art on all of them is achieved by some type of deep learning method, be it LSTM RNNs, DeepMLP, or CNNs. What's interesting to note is that almost every benchmark uses a different method to achieve state of the art. Now, I won't discuss all the previous works, but I do want to mention two which are mostly related to our work. So the first is by Joderberg, Simonian, Vedaldi, and Zisserman, and handles the problem of scene text recognition. In their work, they presented several methods, but the most effective one simply uses a convolutional neural network to do multi-class classification of 90,000 words. So to train their network, they've generated approximately 9 million images by rendering the entire lexicon with various fonts, colors, borders, and projections. And they got state-of-the-art results on scene text recognition, but unfortunately, their method cannot be used for handwriting recognition because synthetic font lacks the full variability which handwritten text possess. The work of Almazan, Gordo, Fornes, and Valveni is also very relevant. Our binary attributes are essentially the same, and so is our usage of CCA for recognition. With regards to performance, using deep learning, which was not an easy feat, we got much higher numbers. So without further ado, let me present our method. There are three steps to understand. The first is how to convert a word into an attributes vector. The second is how to convert an image into an attributes vector. And third, how we use the previous two steps to do the actual recognition. So in the first step, we need to take a word. Notice a word, not an image of a word, but literally a textual word, and convert it into a binary vector. So for this, we need to define our attributes. The simplest one, does a word contain the letter A? If it does, we'll mark it as 1, otherwise we'll mark it as 0. So this gives us 36 attributes, 36 because of the number of letters in English and number of digits. And we call these attributes level 1 attributes. So we define now level 2 attributes as, for example, does the word contain the letter A in the second half of the word. So for example, the word optimization contains the letter A in the second half of the word, but doesn't contain it in the first half of the word. So this gives us an additional 72 attributes. And we do the same for level 3, 4, and 5, and also for 50 common bigrams and 20 common trigrams, eventually getting us to a total of 680 binary attributes. So now we want to convert from an image to an attributes vector. So we take our training set, and we take the words in the training set and convert them to binary vectors using step 1. So now we have images and we have binary vectors. So we can train a convolutional neural network to simultaneously predict all of the attributes, solving a multi-label problem. Now, our network has a somewhat unique structure, which I'll soon review, but I first want to explain the benefits of using an attributes-based model versus a word-based model. So the first is that an attributes-based model utilizes the data much more efficiently. So consider an example of a training set of 1,000 words, and the word sleep appears only twice. So training a word-based model to predict the word sleep is a hard task, whereas words which contain the letter S are much more frequent, making this task much easier to learn. Now, since handwriting recognition benchmarks usually have scarce amounts of data, this presents a big advantage. The second advantage is better described as a lack of a disadvantage. So consider the words kids and beads. These words have very similar structure, but for a word-based model, they are different, just like kids and encyclopedias are different. Now, since these two words do have common similarities, this makes a word-based model harder to train to distinguish between the two, whereas an attributes-based model uses this similarity for its advantage. So a little about the network architecture. Most of it is pretty straightforward. We use a VGG style network. So this means small 3x3 filters and deep, in the old meaning of deep, 12 layers total, 9 convolutional and 3 fully connected. We use max pooling, max out, drop out, batch normalization and data augmentation. And what makes our network structure a little unique is our usage of fully connected branches. So a typical convolutional neural network usually looks like a sequence of layers with the last fully connected layer generating all of the outputs. In our network, we first divide our attributes into several groups and then allocate a fully connected branch to predict each such group. So the motivation is that this allows the fully connected branches to specialize in different regions of the world. So for example, we have a fully connected branch which only predicts attributes from the first half of the word. We use simple data augmentation by rotating and shearing every training image. And we also use it in testing. So given a test image, we generate its variants, pass all of them through the network, and average the prediction vector. We use standard stochastic gradient descent for training, and we do gradual training over the fully connected branches. So this means we first train using one fully connected branch, and once it converges, we add another fully connected branch and continue training. And we found this gradual way of training to produce superior results over training all the attribute groups at once. So quick recap. In the first step, I've shown you how to convert a word into a binary vector. And in the second step, we've shown how to convert an image into a probability vector. And in the third step, we need to compare between these two types of vectors. So for this, we use a canonical correlation analysis, or CCA, to find a common space where these two types of vectors are naturally comparable. So for this, we take the validation set, convert the words into binary vectors using step one, and the images into probabilities vector using step two, and then train the CCA to find the common space. And the outputs of CCA are two transformations, one from the binary space into the common space, and one from the probability space into the common space. Now, during test, we take the entire lexicon, convert it into binary vectors, and project it into the common space. And given a test image, we run the network on it, getting a probabilities vector, and project it into the common space. And now it's a simple matter of nearest neighbor search to find the predicted word in the projected lexicon space. So a few results. So here are some samples from all the handwriting recognition benchmark we've used. Odd rows show typical mistakes, while even rows show successful predictions. And we also use a variant of this system for doing part number recognition. So in part number recognition, the inputs are images of metallical objects with engraved serial numbers. Some of them are extremely hard to read. And using our method, we got near perfect result in this task. Bottom line, using our method, we got state-of-the-art results on every single benchmark we could find. In fact, in handwriting recognition, we reduced the current error rate by 50% on all of them. That's all I have to say. Thank you for your attention.